Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following.
Concedes that jazz hangs in there, by comparison with rock music and even country and western, its constituency is small. There is considerable speculation on the subject, some of it confusing, some abstract, some arresting. For instance, the thesis of one of our guests today, that jazz has graduated into the classical music of America, and the classical music of whatever genre is for the cultivated taste. So how do we talk about that? The idea was to bring two distinguished jazz pianists who are also marvelously articulate to toss the idea around and to illustrate by playing. Towards the end of the hour, we'll let them play together and just see what happens. William Edward Taylor, universally known as Billy, was born in North Carolina and schooled in Virginia, earning his doctorate at Clark College. It is hard to say what he hasn't accomplished. He is a performer, a lecturer, a regular television host, a radio station owner, a soloist with symphony orchestras, a trustee of the Rockefeller Foundation, a member of the National Council of the Arts, and a composer. Dick Wellstood was born in Greenwich, Connecticut, and is very mysterious about his schooling, though he agrees to divulge that he studied with Richard McClanahan in New York, who also taught Mr. Taylor. The music critic Nat Hedoff considers Dick Wellstood possibly the leading jazz pianist of the day. He has played everywhere, spending 4 months of every year abroad. At the moment, he is playing nightly at Hanratty's in New York on 2nd Avenue and 92nd Street. I'm afraid we're going to have to begin with some definitions that will be considered obvious by many listeners, but are essential to us simple-minded folk. For instance, how exactly does one draw the line, Mr. Taylor, between rock and jazz?
Well, one way is that jazz has a tradition, and that tradition extends back about 100 or so years. It's based on the same kind of musicality that gave us the spiritual, the blues, and ragtime, and many other aspects of Americana in terms of music. Rock and roll came about in the 60s, late 50s and early 60s, and was a conscious effort by primarily white artists to perform in a way that was black. And so Bill Haley and Elvis Presley and many others took aspects of the blues and put that together with country and western and other American kinds of popular music, and were merchandised as something very special. And ultimately, they did become something which was not only very musical in its own way, but which had rhythmic ties to the jazz that we know. Rock and roll's kind of, it's right out of the blues. I mean, that's that kind of bass line, which many rock and roll artists used in the beginning, was used by boogie-woogie pianists. So the rhythmic impulses of what they were doing was quite different from what came out of middle-class America.
Well, is it possible musically to take any tune that came out of the jazz tradition that you speak of and transform it into rock, or does it just simply sound incongruous? Is it simply
It sounds incongruous because it goes the other way. What usually happens is that since
is this
jazz,
a harmonic point you're making, or
yes,
a melodic point, or what?
On all three levels, melodic, harmonic, and rhythmic. Jazz is a way of playing, and it deals with extemporaneous compositions, creating something extemporaneously on a harmonic, melodic, and rhythmic level as as the mood comes to you. But you have to know the language, so you have to be basically instilled with the language. Rock and roll has not developed a separate language to that extent, but what it has is a vernacular within that language. Mm-hmm. So it's possible to do certain things. Out of the blues, but it's one of the things that in early rock people used to do a lot to get the kind of rhythmic propulsion that they felt was necessary for their vocals.
And you can apply these techniques and to older tunes and make it sound like rock, but it's inauthentic.
Yeah, because
you have to write a fresh score. In other words,
what happened was that the thing that most rock musicians tried to get was the same kind of spontaneity mm-hmm. using their own vernacular. Mm-hmm. They didn't wish to emulate jazz musicians, and
right.
in some cases they didn't have the technical facility to do that. So they developed another kind of playing the drum, another way of playing the drums, mm-hmm. Another way of approaching the piano and electronic instruments.
Well, now are they interchangeable skills? For instance, can you play rock?
I have. I don't. I've made rock and roll records.
You have?
Yeah, but I have. It's something I really have to work at. I have to get a piece and say, oh, this is what the group needs, or this is what they expect in this particular kind of performance. Mm-hmm. And I try to do that.
Now, in your experience, Dick, what is it that causes some people to wait in line, as they did in Newport, for sometimes 2-3 days to get into a jazz concert, when people of exactly the same age wouldn't come close to jazz, but would get into line for a rock concert? What is it in a 19-year-old that will bring him to jazz, have you any idea, as distinguished from rock and roll?
It's been so long, I can't remember what goes on in a 19-year-old mind. In my case, it's been years. I don't know. When do they stand in line for jazz concerts for 3 days? Did they do that?
Yeah.
In sure. Newport, for instance?
Yeah.
Well, rock more so than jazz is sort of a social scene. I mean, something like Woodstock. I mean, jazz was Charlie Mingus playing for 70 people down at the old Five Spot, and the Woodstock's whatever it was, half a quarter of a million people sitting out in the mud or something. I mean, it's they really weren't there to listen to the music, although they might have thought that they were. But it was more of a social scene, and rock has always had that aspect to it.
And is it if they had been, for instance, if you had performed at Woodstock, would that have turned them right off? Is there a disaffinity between the two modes, as far in your experience?
Well, I don't know, but leaving me out of it for a minute, I don't think it's possible to play. It could have been Art Tatum. I don't think Art Tatum could have performed outdoors for 250,000 people either, or anybody who was doing anything that was very subtle. Because you just can't put it across in those circumstances. Mm-hmm. You couldn't play Bach on the harpsichord for 250,000 people either.
Well, I suppose you turn over the problem to somebody to amplify it, right? And,
well, you're the harpsichord. Yeah.
Well, okay, we've got then some idea of a chronology, but let's start at the other end. What is it that brought a spiritual and made it the blues?
Well,
what was that transition?
Well, the blues, well, for instance, the spiritual. Now, the feeling of that, which was a Sunday kind of feeling, a feeling of prayer and so forth, is very similar. It's just the words in some cases that are different. Since I don't sing, I was trying to do pianistically what a vocalist who was singing in a blues vein might do with that theme.
So there you can preserve pretty well intact the melody.
Yes.
And simply handle it differently.
Yes.
And now, when you talk about black music, the spiritual comes instantly to mind, doesn't it?
Right.
And would that be true, in your opinion, also of the blues?
Yes. The blues chronologically came a little later.
Yeah.
Spiritual was a group expression of a particular feeling, a particular time. It came out of slavery. A little later, in the period of people working on plantations and so forth, the secular music came about. And it had the same kind of feeling. As a matter of fact, in the spiritual, one finds the same kind of feeling that's found in early ragtime. You hear a kind of a syncopation, and it's implied in the music itself. That was in the spirituals, and it was in the early blues and in the early secular music created by black people. But the significant thing is not that it was created, to me, was not that it was created by black people, but it became so important that people who were not black from other ethnic groups felt that it was important enough for them to be able to express themselves through that medium. And that broadened it and gave it another kind of perspective for the country.
And this would have happened chronologically about when? After the First World War?
No, it began to happen during slavery. Because, not with jazz, but with early black music, because this was a country of small towns, and you were limited in terms of how you could travel, so you entertain yourself. And so if you could teach someone or have someone perform for you, then everyone was entertained in that context. And in many small towns, the entertainment was provided by slaves, people who played the fiddle, banjos, and so forth.
Well, but you wouldn't go so far, would you, as to say that there is a distinctive black style in jazz playing, is there?
If you mean, can I tell the difference between a black person and a white person? No, not today. At one point I could, but at this point I can't. If Dick and I play together, I guarantee that if we played certain things, it would be very difficult, unless you were looking at us, to tell who was who.
Would you go with that statement that stylistically there is no residual black or white mannerisms in jazz?
Well, jazz has come to be such a catch-all thing. If you're talking about early jazz, or certainly contemporary jazz, is all over the place, and you can't even tell whether they're Americans half the time,
right.
You know, or anything. It's very cosmopolitan music nowadays. Contemporary jazz. I mean that I don't play that way, but
you don't play what way?
I mean the real modern. I play traditional jazz.
Yeah.
I'm a traditionalist of one sort or another. Yeah. And nowadays they're into all kinds of things.
And the traditional jazz would have consolidated in what, the 20s, would you say, or later?
Again, it began to consolidate with ragtime. I think Scott Joplin and Jelly Roll, chronologically, Scott Joplin, Jelly Roll Morton, Fletcher Henderson, and others who sort of put certain parts of the language that we all use in place. And they codified it to an extent that Dick can go back and really get some of the ragtime pieces and play them today with the feeling, though in his own style, that some of the earlier performers intended it to be. That's why I think it's a classical thing. In the same way you can get, you play Bach as Bach intended it, you play Beethoven, Debussy, as that music was intended to be played. Stylistically, Dick is one of the very best I know who can take the music of Jelly Roll Morton or the music of Fats Waller or some of the earlier pianistic players and play it in that style, which is quite different from what we do now.
Well, let's see if Mr. Taylor is deceiving us about that. How about giving us something as Jelly Roll Morton might have played it?
That's putting me on the spot. Why don't you pick somebody else?
Okay, like, Fats Waller.
All right, well, I could play one of Fats's songs, like Ain't Misbehaving or
okay.
Something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, let's see how it goes.
Thank you.
Like it?
Yeah, very much.
Is that distinctive, or is that, should that be understood as an effort to play it as Fats Waller would have played it?
No, that's Fats Waller as interpreted by Dick Wellstead.
I see.
Because what he did was to use the stride style that Fats Waller, which is a note, a chord, and then a note on the first beat, a chord on the second beat, a note on the third beat, and at one point he was playing tenths, which Fats also did. And stylistically, he incorporated many of the things, especially in the left hand that Fats was doing rhythmically.
Now, stride is just that, just what you say, is nothing else than that?
Yeah, stride
note,
piano.
Chord.
Yeah.
Oh, we're using tense or not using tense?
Both. The style is a feeling of one, two, three, four, one, like that. So, essentially, that's stride. So, there are many variations. And you can do other things with it, as the earlier pianists did.
Now, was Jelly Roll, somebody once told me that Jelly Roll Morton presented himself to the Library of Congress in the late 40s when he found out he was dying of cancer. And he sort of rang the bell and said, I'm the greatest living jazz pianist, and I'm dying, and I'm willing to play my whole repertoire for you if you get yourself a recording machine. And apparently he did so. What was it about Jelly Roll Morton that jazz musicians especially remarked? Was it the way he played, or was it a style that he developed?
Jelly Roll Morton was a giant in his time. What he did, he used to go to the Creoles had an opera house, and he would go to hear the opera, and he incorporated many of the things out of the European tradition into what was then traditional in the New Orleans style of playing. New Orleans style, which we now call Dixieland and many other terms, had to do with very orchestral kind of ragtime. Mm-hmm. There was a first theme, a second theme, and a third theme, over which the trumpet usually played the melody, and the clarinet played an obbligato, and so forth. And what he did was to as a composer arranger, put that on the piano.
Can you give us an idea?
Well, not too well. One of the things that he did, he would do those kinds of things that had to do with playing four beats of the measure. And then he would go into more of the stride kind of thing. And in many cases, he would try to get his left hand to sound like the trombone. And so you would hear kind of a Dixieland band all together in his piano playing. And he organized the music as Scott Joplin had before him in a way that other people could say, hey, that's the form. Let me do something of my own within that form. And he was one of the very best organizers in those days.
Well, would he therefore only play by himself, or would he also play with bands?
Oh, he played with bands. He was a soloist. He played in the Storyville district of New Orleans. Mm-hmm. But he then left and toured, went to California, went to many other places with seven-piece groups, with larger groups. He was one of the first, I guess, in those days to have about a 10 or 12-piece group that was playing jazz, because that was all he wanted to do.
And did fame come to him early, or was he known only to the cognoscenti?
No, he was fairly, he was pretty famous in the early days, but times changed, and I guess he didn't, in terms of the music business, he didn't keep up with the time. So mm-hmm. Even though Fletcher Henderson and other people used his material, mm-hmm. the way he played them, it was considered corny.
I see.
I remember the first time I ever heard him was in Washington, D.C., around the time that you were talking about, and I went to listen to him and kind of sneer at him because I was already listening to Art Tatum and Teddy Wilson, and I thought this was a corny old fellow. And about five of us who were pianists went in to hear him. He was playing at a place called the Jungle Inn. And he sat down and played something in the key of E natural, which was difficult for me to do in those days, and began to really play all of these old things using the entire instrument and in a very orchestral way. And just blew me away. I had never heard ragtime or anything else played like that. And I gained a whole new kind of respect for what he did as an artist and stopped sneering and said, hey, let me try to learn how to do my left hand like that.
Yeah. And there has been a revival, or does nobody seek to play the the way he does?
Oddly enough, the revival of jazz is in the hands of young white musicians. And I am really amazed at the authenticity of some of the performances. I've heard student groups who played, who took a record and listened to every note on the record. Each guy got his own instrument, and they played it, and the style was so perfect, they even went back and got some of the mannerisms that they were told. These are 17 and 18 year olds. They were told, the guys threw their horns up in the air and they did this kind of stuff. So they do all of that. and it's just amazing, because having seen some of Sidney Lee Parrish and Sidney Bechet and people like that, and seeing them as they did that, and to see these kids come along, and they've got all the mannerisms and everything with it. It's beautiful.
It's like the recreation of the Glenn Miller Band 20 years later.
Yeah, it's like that, except it's more difficult. What they did orchestrally, you could hear, Glenn Miller was a fine orchestrator, but you could hear the kind of chunks of sound that he, how he orchestrated that. These are little solo bits that are going all over the place, mm-hmm. and you've got to really, on old 78s and things like that, it's very difficult to hear.
Yeah.
And it amazes me that they can take these things off the record.
Yeah, yeah. Well, when jazz went on into the 30s, it was dominated, or was it, by Gershwin?
No, I don't think so.
Well, you're probably thinking
in terms of songs, and
I think in terms of a musical presence, he was sort of the ranking figure, wasn't he, during the 30s? Or was that
He was as a composer, and his music was used by many musicians because he had some of the most popular music of the 30s, popular to jazz musicians. The things that he wrote, I Got Rhythm, and pieces like that were used just endlessly as vehicles for improvisation. But the jazz musicians like Duke Ellington, Chick Webb, Fletcher Henderson, and many others that were more in the tradition were doing another kind of material, similar to what Gershwin was writing in his popular tunes, but from their own perspective.
Jazz is not, one difference between jazz and rock is that jazz is not a song-oriented music, really. It's rock, I mean, songs in the sense of lead or something, in other words, a song to be sung as words and melody and so on. Rock is based on songs. And jazz hasn't been really for 50 years. There are lots of people who sing, but that's not the same thing. Jazz is an instrumental music, and you can't sing an Art Tatum solo, and you can't sing a Beethoven symphony. Mm-hmm. And Beethoven wasn't song-oriented either. Mm-hmm. And so, as far as Gershwin being a jazz figure, he wrote a lot of songs that musicians used as bases for improvisation, like I Got Rhythm and so on. But that in itself wouldn't make him a jazz figure, because they could have just as easily been playing the beer barrel polka or something, as James Moody did the other night, I read in the paper, and use that as the basis for their improvisation.
I think the thing that confused it was the fact that Gershwin himself was a good jazz pianist. Mm. He played pretty much like Fats Waller, and he liked the music of Art Tatum, invited him to parties and listened to him and emulated some of the things that he did. So when he wrote, for instance, Rhapsody in Blue, he had in mind what a jazz pianist would do with that. If you listen to his record of the Rhapsody, then you hear a totally different thing from what Oscar Levon and other classically oriented people ultimately did with the piece of music. It's a great piece of music, but his interpretation of it, Gershwin's interpretation, was more from a jazz point of view, because he knew what that was about.
I see. Let's try an experiment. Let's take I Got Rhythm. You give me an interpretation of it, and then we'll ask Mr. Taylor to give an interpretation of it to test the versatility of the actual song. Is that a good one to play with or not?
I will, if I must.
Well,
sure. It's not one that I usually play, as a matter of fact.
The Constitution protects you against involuntary servitude.
Why don't we let Billy play it? Because I don't usually play it, as a matter of fact.
Well, no, I want a song that both of you will play, one after the other, just because I think it would be interesting to take a song and show two very different treatments of it, because one of the things about jazz is that it brings out the incredible prodigality of talent of people who can hear it a different way.
Sure. What would you like to
play? What about something like George on My Mind? Or something like that.
Fine.
All right. Do you want to go first?
I'll do a chorus and then you do a chorus.
Okay.
All right?
Sure. Now, who wrote that?
Hoagy Carmichael.
Of course. Thank you. Okay, now, if one were a jazz critic, one would characterize that as having been played in what style?
I don't know. I wasn't listening.
That's the trouble with reading about jazz. It's not easy to know how to characterize it in any formal way.
Well, you can, but that's after the fact. I think what Dick was doing is, as he characterized it earlier, is in the mainstream of jazz, which is a very wide, gives him a lot of leeway in that at one point he was doing something that I associated with Art Tatum, which was a kind of rubato way of playing.
Yeah.
Then he went into tempo doing things which were much more from the kind of piano that I like to play and he likes to play, which is based on the stride style, but which is a little more of today. For instance, if I were to do the same thing,
that's nice.
Thank you. Well, I based what I did on what he did. See, I the only thing I didn't do was modulate on the last eight. He went from F to A flat, and I was already in B flat, so I decided I'd stay there.
Now, how would a music critic characterize the difference stylistically between those two versions?
Well, stylistically, I think they're pretty much in the same place, except the personal ideas of the player come through. He has a way of playing with his left hand is different from the way his hand's probably larger than mine, and so he does things with his left hand which are very which I like very much because it's very stylistically interesting, and I had to really work my hand is not really that big, and so I had to work to learn to do those kinds of things which I heard Tatum do, and it makes a nice pianistic sound for me, but it's not something I did easy. I can do it much better now, but it took me a while.
Till you were 16?
At least.
Okay. Now, on the matter of improvisation, is there any other music that relies as heavily on improvisation as jazz?
Indian music.
Is there any other form of music?
Indian music, ragas, is very improvised. They have specific kinds of you have a basic rocker, and the players do a lot of improvisation on it. And I think in that regard, jazz as classical music is very similar. Because it does, Indian music is not written. It's based on a particular perspective of that culture. Jazz, generally speaking, is not written. It's an oral tradition, if you will, and it's transmitted in that way. Master to pupil, in many cases.
Well, Do I understand you to be saying that throughout the history of music, improvisation always went on, but in jazz, people don't bother to set it down because it's going to vary, and it's expected to vary.
Sometimes we now set it down. I mean, in the last 50 years or so, people have become much more literate and have begun to write, Scott Joplin, for instance, and Jelly Roll Morton wrote their music down because they wanted people to play it a certain way, even though they realized that to give it to someone else, it was going to be played differently, even though it was written. This was true of Bach. When Bach had to write something every Sunday, he didn't bother to write the keyboard part because he wrote the figured bass. And so he improvised, even though the singers had their music and they had to sing the words and the music that he wrote. He just kind of wrote what we call a lead sheet, and went, you know, played so that he'd have a guide to know where they were, and did things like that. Debussy was an excellent improviser also. Mm-hmm.
Well, they didn't in those days write out the cadenzas, did they?
No, they didn't.
That was up to the individual artist.
Right.
But Beethoven, wasn't it he who
decided to put an end to that? He said, I want it this way.
Yeah.
You haven't had to write out a lot of jazz things because jazz has had phonograph records, you know, and mm-hmm. and people could learn to listen to someone like Art Tatum, say, without having to read it, thank God, off the... you can buy a record, listen to it, or
just
a Lester Young solo or whatever it might be, you know, Charlie Parker. You know, I'm sure Charlie Parker had most of his influence without anybody ever seeing one of his solos written out.
Mm-hmm. By just listening to them.
By just listening to them. You haven't had that, and you didn't have that in the past, and so that's one reason you had written music.
Yeah. Well, at a certain point, is it true about jazz that the listener recognizes as authentic a particular way of playing it?
Yes.
And that people feel a sense of disappointment if they hear it played differently.
Yes.
And is that the result of experience, or is that the result of attempting to recapture what was in the imagination of the composer?
No, I think it's a matter of communication. You responded to something that I played a moment ago because it obviously you liked what you heard.
Yeah.
That's the basis of jazz. Most people who listen respond, find something in it that they can respond to. If not, they go on to another kind of music. But having listened to a lot of jazz, they can be very selective as someone who listens to all of the Bach preludes and all of the many other kinds of things. Say, I really like counterpoint, so I'm going to listen to Bach and really listen to this. Well, you don't have to be a musician to really hear it and appreciate the movement of the voices and the way the counterpoint moves, and say, well, that's just beautiful. I like that.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Just as you can a painting.
Yes,
without
absolutely.
Being able to analyze it.
Sure.
Now, you made a point in the correspondence we had a while ago about jazz as repertory, that there are recognizable, quote-unquote, classics.
I got that from Billy over the telephone.
Yeah.
That's why I put it in my letter.
Yeah.
There are repertory groups forming, and the Smithsonian has one, and there are lots of groups that are playing the music of Jelly Roll Morton and so on. And I wouldn't have thought that this was a thing to do, but maybe this is an answer. Maybe this is the only way to keep that music alive, is to have people play it in repertory.
Well, I think in the broader sense, it's done in a way, for instance, you know pieces of Fats Waller, you know pieces of Duke Ellington, you know, as I do, music of Charlie Parker and various pieces. So I can play, for instance, Stompin' at the Savoy was a song out of the 30s, which Benny Goodman and Chick Webb and many other groups play. It was part of that part of the repertory.
This was Edgar
Sampson, I believe, that wrote that. Ellington wrote so many pieces that Don't Mean a Thing If It Ain't Got That Swing. He wrote Mood Indigo. I played this for Dick a little earlier. That's called Drop Me Off in Harlem, and Ellington wrote it with Nick Kenny, of all people. But it's an authentic stride piece that he used to play along those lines.
He did not write A-Train, though.
No, he did not.
Everybody
Billy
thinks he did.
Sure.
How does A-Train go?
That was his theme song.
Yeah.
Well, he didn't use one of his own songs.
No. He and Billy Strayhorn were interchangeable. Billy wrote a lot of things with him, but that one Billy Strayhorn wrote by himself. Wrote that and several others. Yeah. But Ellington just used it because he loved him.
What is stylistically distinctive about Count Basie? Does he get a slot of his own?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
And what would be a typical Count Basie piece, either written by himself or played by him?
Well, the 1 o'clock jump, I guess, is his most famous piece, and in it, he does some things which are out of the Kansas City kind of blues and out of the stride piano style that he got from Fats Waller and Earl Hines. He just plays this with one hand, and the bass plays something else, and he plays blues figures, and to me, all the time, the bass player is playing figures like this, which gives him room to say, and those little things that he does, which are really, Waller used to do. No things like that, and he did many of the kinds of things that Basie now incorporates stylistically in what he does. But he does it in a very forceful way. He's one of the best rhythm players in terms of supporting a soloist that I've ever heard. It's just the band sounds different if he's not on the bandstand.
He almost gives them a percussive
absolutely, another effect. Kind of lift.
Yeah, a few years ago, the Time Life people did remakes of all the big bands. They did Benny Goodman, they did Harry James, and this one and that one. And the lady who was in charge of all this, this was maybe 10 years ago, she told me that the one that gave her the most trouble was Count Basie, because they couldn't find anybody to play. Basie doesn't do anything, something, that's it. Yeah. That's all he does. Uh-huh. But it's how he does it and where he does it that made all the difference. They couldn't get anybody. I don't know who they finally got. They finally found somebody who could come close. But that simple sounding thing was the thing that gave them the most trouble to recreate.
What were they working off, music? I mean, I take it that they didn't have any photographs that they could imitate.
I guess they took someone took the arrangements off the records, or they got a hold of the arrangements, the original things, you know, of maybe 1 o'clock jump or whatever it was. Mm-hmm. And but that, as simple as Basie does those things, it's rhythmically he's a genius. It's impossible to really reproduce what he does. Mm-hmm. But when you say, if you said to me, play like Count Basie, I go, I do that.
That's it.
That's it, you know.
Well, now, where does Broadway music come in? Is that always has kind of a sentimental feel to it, doesn't it?
In many cases. Broadway, up until, I guess, from the 20s till the mid-30s, was very, many of the things that were used on Broadway were very much in the jazz camp. Louis Armstrong played Broadway shows. Bands played four Broadway shows, so that there was a possibility of an interchange. U.B. Blake wrote the music for Broadway shows. And so when he wrote writing one of the vehicles that musicians like Lionel Hampton and all kinds of other, Louis Armstrong, and other people were going to use as a point of improvisation, because that was what his background was.
I see.
And Fats Waller also wrote many of his most memorable tunes for Broadway shows. So Broadway played an important part until writers like Rodgers and Hart and others began to really go in another direction, a more classically oriented, European classically oriented way. And so they extended Broadway in another direction, which was beautiful because they came up with lovely songs, but it was a different direction.
And it became less like jazz.
But the material that they created for another purpose entirely, it was still appropriated by jazz.
I mean,
Richard Rodgers tunes. And many of his melodies are just lovely, and they were used, and still are used. As a matter of fact, I played one earlier today at a performance, My Romance. Now, I play it in a different way. I play it, you know, in a jazz style, but he wrote it to be sung beautifully for, you know, handsome fellow singing to a beautiful girl.
Pretty girl like a melody.
You're right.
How would you play that in the jazz style, what you just did?
Thank you.
rescue mission. Can you save a pretty girl? There's like a melody. Can you make it sound?
Oh God.
Sound other than sort of sick and sentimental.
Let's see. You're really throwing some things at me today. That was only the last half of the chorus. I don't know the first half.
Well, tell me, Mr. Taylor, what do you, having developed as a distinctive part of American culture, why was jazz so slow in crossing international frontiers by contrast with rock, which crossed them almost with the speed of light?
Well, rock came about in the time of media hype, and it was possible for it to move with a much faster speed. You had television, you had recordings, you had movies, you had all kinds of media assistance for the music. Plus, you were caught up in a cultural period in which a large majority of people related to the image and the imagery sold. Rock was merchandised by the music business, by many other kinds of businesses, capitalizing on the existence of a youthful audience that had a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And so many of the things that became socially acceptable to be done in the social context of rock were done within this age group. And it was a very valid and a very important part of the 60s. Jazz, on the other hand, had enjoyed many areas of development in the 20s. It was the music of the 30s when people were jitterbugging in the aisles and so forth. But it never enjoyed the meteor kind of presentation. There have not been the great jazz artists, for instance, like Ella Fitzgerald, Duke Ellington, and many others, never had their own TV shows. So it was not possible for them to do what the Captain and Tennille do, or what other people who are certainly do what they do very well, but they do it in another context.
Well, do you think that the audience was potentially there in as large a size as for rock?
Yes. It's been proven in Europe. All over Europe, there are people, jazz is studied. We were in Budapest last June, and I was quite pleasantly surprised to find that it was studied, it was taught in the conservatory there. In many places, one can start in late May and go until October playing two or three jazz festivals a week throughout Europe. Yes. And many, many artists do that. So the whole summer is taken up with outdoor festivals playing our music. And as Dick pointed out earlier, many of the players are now European because they've heard so many records that they can do it as well as many Americans. The music is a valid means of personal expression, which is what makes it attractive to many creative players.
Are they also composing it?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Finland has a tremendous amount of jazz composers.
Is that right?
Yeah. I'm surprised.
My God! Imagine producing Sibelius and jazz composers. when you play in Europe, Dick, is there any noticeable difference in the quality of the reaction? I mean, do some pieces that go here just collapse there, or vice versa?
No, not usually. The only thing. The audiences are very receptive over there. The only thing that amazed me is that the appreciation is more widespread. For instance, one night in Switzerland outside of Bern, I played in a shopping center, 8 o'clock Friday night. And it was a little bandstand set up, and I had to play some solo piano. And I know if I did that in New Jersey, Long Island, I'd die the death of a dog out there. But I played in Switzerland solo,
And there were about 400 people there, and they're absolutely quiet, and they were entranced by me playing the piano in a shopping center when they're out there with baby carriages and everything. This was not a jazz audience. These were just Swiss off the street. And to that extent, the Europeans, I think, are more receptive. The average person, not just the jazz fans are usually receptive, you know, the concert audiences and so on. That's fine, but it goes beyond that in Europe.
Yeah.
You hear more jazz on the television, on the radio, various sorts of jazz as background for stuff and commercials and fade-ins and bridges and stuff, much more than you do here.
Mm-hmm. One thing I've never asked you isn't it terribly disconcerting to play when nobody's listening?
Depends. Not for me, because I normally play for myself, and I play, if there's... what is disconcerting, if you play at a nightclub, and there's someone sitting right here or right here, and they're right in your ear, and you can't hear the piano, then that's very disconcerting. But if you can get them to move away, I mean, forget it, I'll just go on.
That's when it gets bad. I don't mind if they talk or build boats or anything when I'm playing, but as long as I don't have to listen to it when I'm trying to play.
But you always get that lady who, with a shrill voice, who's got a lot to say to her friend, who says, put me right by the piano. Yeah. And so she sits right here, and she's going to talk to her friend. That's fine, but talk to her over there somewhere.
The trouble in New York clubs is that you'll get, I don't want to name the place, but there used to be a place I played where 90% of the people didn't even know there was any music there at all. They just come in to get something to eat. And the other 10% of the people were head of Newport Jazz Festival, a jazz critic from New York Times and so on. They're all in there to hear you play. You see? Mm-hmm. And then so for them, you have to turn it on. But everybody else is talking. You can't hear it. That gets bad.
In other words, if the noise is too much, it interferes with the inflections of the piano, and you can't see, you can't hear what you're doing. Yeah. It ruins the concentration. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Why is it the people who play classical music can't ever have a drink before they play, but people who play jazz, well, I was thinking about Tatum, because I read a piece about him recently, seem to have no difficulty. Is it because you're always playing by ear, and under the circumstances, your fingers are just going to pretty much express what you want them to express?
I'm amazed at anyone who can do that. I cannot. It goes straight to my fingers. I cannot drink when I perform. And most people that I know, Art Tatum included, did not play as well when they were under the influence
of anything.
Right? That's true. I work with Billie Holiday. I work with several people who had serious drug problems. And whenever they were under the influence of whatever drug they used, whiskey or whatever, they did not play the same. And to my ear, it was not quite as creative or as good by their standards as it was when they were not under the influence of whatever that was.
Now, when they listened to recordings of themselves, would they be able to pick this
absolutely.
Up?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Charlie Parker was one of the first to admit that when many kids were emulating him, he said, don't do what I do because that is not what makes me play. I'm playing in spite of that, and it's really a deterrent. Mm-hmm. And he tried to, in many cases, dissuade people from using the kind of drugs that he was using.
So therefore, my generality simply does not. It's not.
I think
true.
many players believe that there's some kind of stimulant will help them, mm-hmm. but I think if with all of the recording tech, all the recording equipment we have now, that's easily disproved. If someone who's sober performs on tape, and then when he's or she is not. Performs on tape. I think it's a noticeable difference in most cases.
Is it a loss of muscular control or is it a loss of musical judgment?
Both. There's a discipline that has to do with doing whatever you do. I mean, you're doing it in your style, so I can't tell you what's going to come next. You have to figure that out. You have to make the muscles do that. And if you are, for any reason, very relaxed and laid back, then that's going to come out that way. If you're aggressive and really into it, it's going to come out that way. Whatever your personal way of doing those things will come out in your playing. So if anything interferes with the discipline, the self-imposed discipline, then it changes it.
Would the performance of a jazz pianist differ as much from night to night, say, as that of a classical pianist?
Well, more.
More.
Sure, because...
Because you're not playing set notes.
You're not playing set notes, and just because you're improvising doesn't mean that you're making something up out of thin air, that you're playing something you never played before, but it does mean that you can change it at any given time, and that maybe you play another chorus or two more choruses, or maybe you played it the same way you did the night before if you remember it.
Yeah.
But everybody, especially in solo playing is different from playing in a group. In solo playing, you sort of have to get set ways of playing your pieces because you need this to hold your performance together. Art Tatum played things like Begin the McGee and Humoresque and so on for years, basically the same way. But if at any time he felt like changing them, he did. He could and he did. And that's improvising.
But his mood would definitely affect the success of his performance. I mean, if he was feeling good, or if the audience gave him a lift, or whatever.
I imagine
or
so,
is
sure.
He professional enough to come out with something that's always good, no matter what the objective circumstance, surrounding circumstances?
It would depend on the performer, not specifically talking about Tatum. Some performers are more emotional than others and do a more emotional thing, less cerebral. More cerebral players would probably play pretty much the same wouldn't react with the audience. It depends on who you are and what you do.
Right. Well, I promised the audience that I would ask you to conclude the program by playing something together. And I asked you just before we went on, and I guess you came up with Indiana, didn't you, Ms. Taylor?
Yeah, well.
Well, since I won't have a chance to thank you at the end of the program, I'd like to thank you a whole lot and tell you that I think you're both super.
Thank you.
And so let's go out with Indiana. Is that how they say it?
Indiana.
Okay.
funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following. For a printed-bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content.